The following is a class on the Bhagavad Gita as it is, third chapter, text number 29 through 43, given by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, recorded on January 1st, 1969, in Los Angeles.
What is Vedic wisdom? Vedasya sadvi ahameva vidyam. Knowledge. Veda means knowledge. What is perfect knowledge? Perfect knowledge is that my constitutional position is to serve. Bring any man in this world who can say that I am not servant. Is there any man or woman within this world, within this universe, who is not a servant? Can any one of you say that you are not servant? Is there anyone? Everyone is servant. Somebody is servant of the society. Somebody is servant of the country, somebody is servant of his wife or family, or some cats and dogs, ultimately. One must be a servant. So, when a man comes to this knowledge that I am serving, so why not serve the Supreme? This is knowledge. This is perfect knowledge. Nobody can be freed from being a servant. Either you become a servant of God or you become a servant of dog. You must be a servant. So the intelligent person, a wise person, he prefers to be servant of God, instead of becoming servant of dog. There is no escape that one cannot. One is master. Nobody is master. Everyone is servant. Therefore, one who executes his duties according to my injunction, God's injunction, and who follows the teachings faithfully becomes free from bondage. As soon as you become servant to somebody besides God, then you are in bondage. You are in obligation. Obligation there is, but that is not bondage. To become servant of God is not bondage. But servant of dog is a bondage. So, the intelligent person is he who knows that I am servant. So why not become servant of the greatest? Just like somebody wants to be worker in government service. Why? Because government is very big establishment, great establishment. He has got many facilities. There is not bondage. Similarly, why not become the servant of the Supreme Government? That is perfection of knowledge. So long we are not servant of God, that means we are deficient in knowledge. And perfect knowledge is to become servant of God. Because you cannot escape by not being a servant. Everyone has to become a servant, this side or that side.
What is that first day in the jumping without envying the Lord? There are many so-called philosophers who write comments on the Bhagavad Gita but have no faith in Krishna. They will never be liberated from the bondage of spiritual absence. But an ordinary man is first day in the eternal conjunction of the Lord, Beings are unable to execute such orders, become liberated from the bondage of the law of karma. In the beginning of Krishna consciousness, one may not fully discharge the injunctions of the Lord, but because one is not resentful of this principle and works sincerely without consideration of deceit and hopelessness, he will surely be promoted to the stage of pure Krishna consciousness.
Yes. In the beginning, there may be some failure. That is quite natural. Just a child is trying to stand. He may fall down. But that does not mean he should give up the idea. Go on. The time will come when he will be perfect. So we should not give up this business to try to serve the Supreme. Maybe imperfect in the beginning, but stick to it, and a time will come when you will be perfect. Krishna calls.
Very true. But those who out of envy disregard these teachings and do not practice them regularly are to be considered bereft of all knowledge, be fooled and doomed to ignorance and bondage.
Yes. If somebody says, why shall I serve God? All right, then he shall have to serve dogs. That's all. Therefore, he is befooled. He does not know that he has to serve somebody. His constitutional position is like that. He cannot escape. So therefore, if he denies to serve God, Krishna, then he has to serve Maya, illusion, in the hope that I have become the master. Just like in your country, the President Johnson was the master. Actually, he was not the master. He was the servant of the country. Now the country has dismissed him. He is no longer master. So our mastership in this material world is like that. Actually, we are servants, but we are thinking master. In a family, I am servant of my wife, I am servant of my children, I am servant of my servants, but I am thinking I am master. I am master of this family. I am master of this country. I am master of this society. Nobody is master. The Chaitanya Charitamrita says therefore, the master is only Krishna. Ekulak Ishar Krishna Arsa Bhritta. Only Krishna or God is master and everyone is servant. Jare jaiche nathaye setoiche karnitta. Each servant is dancing according to the order of the Supreme. That's all. Nobody is master. So this false conception of becoming master is called maya, illusion. Nobody is master. Therefore, one who disagrees to become servant of God, he is befooled, it is said. But those who, out of envy, he is constitutionally servant, but he is envious. Why shall I become God's servant? I shall become God. You see, everyone is claiming, everyone is God. Why? What is the use of becoming servant of God? I am God. This is envious. So, if one refuses to serve God and becomes envious, disregard these teachings and do not practice them regularly, has to be considered bereft of all knowledge. Because he is servant, but he is thinking, I am master, I am not serving anyone. This is maya, bereft of all knowledge. Go on.
Very true. Even a man of knowledge acts according to his own nature. Everyone follows his nature. What can
be
present in
So at least he is servant of his nature. There are three kinds of material modes of nature. Somebody is in goodness, somebody is in passion, somebody is in ignorance. So in ignorance, somebody say, he is intoxicated. He is servant of some intoxication. But he's thinking after being intoxicated, I am God. I am master. Okay. This is called befooling. He's befooled. He is servant of intoxication and is thinking I am God.
That's it.
Is it not a fact? By meditation, he will become God. If you are God, why you are meditating? Therefore, there before, the direct process is get to Krishna consciousness, I am eternal servant of God. Let me take to this business. Finish. Perfect knowledge. God.
Here Krishna says that
destruction in the course of performing one's own duty is better than engaging in another's duties, for to follow another's path is dangerous. Now, Arjuna was a military man, a kshatriya. His business was to fight for the good cause. But in the battlefield, he thought that why should I engage myself in this killing business? Better retire from it. If I don't get my kingdom, I shall rather beg. This begging business is for us, just like we are sannyasi or a Brahmin. We are allowed to beg. We are not, of course, begging for as professional beggar, but we introduce ourselves as beggar. The Vedic culture is that a sannyasi, when he comes to beg in a householder's house, he receives him very respectfully, and whatever he wants, they want to supply. But they do not want anything. But the introduction is that they take this opportunity of sitting in a householder's home and talk about Krishna consciousness. That is their real business. They are not beggars. Anyway, this begging business is not for a householder or a military man. Therefore, Krishna says that don't try to imitate the business of a sannyasi or a Brahmin. You are kshatriya. Your duty is to fight, so you should follow your own prescribed duty. Don't try to imitate others. But one can attain perfection by being engaged in his own occupation, provided he does it in Krishna consciousness. So Krishna is asking him to fight, and he is a professional fighter. So if he fights in accordance with the order of Krishna, there is his purpose. This is purpose. God.
Therefore, by nature, the living entity is not subjected to the sins of the material world. But factually, when the living entity is in contact with the material nature, he acts in many sinful ways without hesitation. As such, Arjuna's question to Krishna is very sanguine as to the perverted nature of the living entity. Although the living entity sometimes does not want to act in sin, he is still forced to act. This force is not, however, impelled by the super soul living within the living entity, but must be done, but must be due to other causes. And that is explained in the next verse by the Lord. Then he says, the Blessed Lord says, it is lust only, Arjuna, which is born of contact with the material modes of passion and later transformed into wrath, and which is the all-devouring, sinful enemy of this world.
Yes. Passion, if you increase your passion, then when you cannot fulfill your passion, you will be angry, wrath, one after another. So, this is due to our being situated in the modes of passion. As I have told you, there are three kinds of modes of material nature. One is goodness, one is passion, and one is ignorance. So, ignorance is the lowest quality. Passion is still better than ignorance. And goodness is the highest good quality within this material world. And one has to transcend even goodness. Then he can go to the Krishna consciousness platform. So, one should not remain on the platform of passion. He should try to rise on the platform of goodness, and from there he should try to be promoted in Krishna consciousness. This is one method. But if you take to Krishna consciousness directly, then automatically you transcend the platform of ignorance, passion, and goodness. Go on.
As fire is converted by smoke, as fire is covered by smoke, as a mirror is covered by dust, or as the embryo is covered by the womb, similarly, the living entity is covered by different degrees of its
lust. Different degrees of lust. Those who are in the modes of goodness, their lust is a different quality. Those who are in passion, their lust is in different quality. Those who are in ignorance, their lust is different. It is a question just like there are first-class prisoners, second-class prisoners, and third-class prisoners. So, after all, they are prisoners. Maybe first class, second class, or third class. That doesn't matter. Similarly, within this material world, somebody may be very learned, rich, beautiful, and all good qualifications in the modes of goodness. So, they are somebody in passion and somebody in lower degree, or even animal life. But they are all prisoners within this material world. One has to transcend this position. One has to transcend even the so-called goodness of the material world. Just like Arjuna was trying to be so-called good man of this material world. He was trying to avoid the injunction of Krishna. Krishna wanted him that you should fight this Kurukshetra battle. But he wanted to be good man. So, that fighting, when he was convinced of Krishna's instruction, this Bhagavad Gita, that means he transcended even the goodness platform of this material world. So Krishna is trying to raise him to the Traiguna Visayaveda Nistraiguna Bhavarjan. This whole material atmosphere is surcharged with three modes of material nature. So one has to transcend the modes of material nature. Just like one should not try to become a first-class prisoner. In the prison house, if one is a third-class prisoner and one is first-class prisoner, the third-class prisoner should not aspire that let me remain in this prison house and become a first-class prisoner. That is not good. One should transcend the prison walls or come out of the prison house. That is his aim. Go on.
Therefore, if he receives the covenant of the pure living entity, and thereby the pure consciousness of the living entity, or Krishna consciousness, is embarrassed by non-manifestation, this covering is but love. Under different manifestations, like smoke in the fire, dust of the mirror, and the womb of the embryo. When lust is compared to smoke, it is understood that the fire of the living spark can be a little perceived. In other words, when the living entity exhibits his Krishna consciousness presently, he may be likened to the fire covered by smoke. Although fire is necessary when there is smoke, there is no overt manifestation of fire in the early stage. This stage can be compared with the beginning of Krishna consciousness. The comparison of the dust of the mirror refers to the cleansing process of the mirror of the mind by so many spiritual methods. The best process is to chant the holy names of the Lord. The comparison of the embryo being covered by the womb is an analogy illustrating the most awkward position, for the child in the womb is so helpless that it cannot even move. This stage of living condition can be compared also to the trees. The trees are living entities, but they have been put into that condition of life by such a great exhibition of love that they are almost void of all consciousness.
Yes, these trees, we should know that the trees, they are also living entities. But they have been put in such awkward position that they are standing up in a position for thousands of years. They cannot move him. If somebody is cutting, cannot protect. They have been put into such conditional life. If somebody is coming to do some harm, they cannot go away. So, the most abominable conditional life is the tree.
The top of the earth is compared to the birds and beasts, and smoke covered fire is compared to the human beings.
Yes, the birds and beasts, they can move. They can protect themselves from somebody who is coming to hurt. But still, they have no knowledge. They seem a little better than the tree. Gone.
In the form of a human being, the living entity can perceive a little Krishna consciousness. And if you make further development, the fire of spiritual life can be kindled in the human form. By careful handling of the smoke and the fire can be made to blaze.
Yes. When the fire is covered by the smoke, if you little fan over it, then immediately there is blazing fire, immediately smoke is gone. Similarly, Krishna consciousness or God consciousness in every living entity, especially human being, there is, even in the aborigines, those who are called uncivilized. They are also offering some respect to the sea, to the thunderbolt, to a big mountain, something wonderful they offer, they bow down. That means there is Krishna consciousness. So that's like a fire covered in smoke. Now if you fan it, if you just try to eradicate the smoke, the fire will come out. So we should take advantage. We have got now this consciousness, God consciousness. Therefore, in every human society, there is some sort of religious propaganda. Try to understand God. So we should take advantage of it. But instead of taking advantage of this opportunity, we have declared God is dead. I am God, this God, that God. So you are not fanning. There are others going more and more away from God. This should not be done.
In the human form of life, once you conquer the enemy, love, by culture of Krishna consciousness under evil guidance. 39. Thus, a man's pure consciousness is covered by his eternal enemy in the form of love, which is never satisfied and which burns like fire. 40. The senses, the mind, and the intelligence are the sitting places of this love, which veils the real knowledge of the living entity and bewilders him.
Yes, this is very important. The senses, the mind, and the intelligence are the sitting places of this lust. If somebody is lusty and
if one has to search out where that enemy lust is there. So Krishna is giving you direct information, here is your enemy. Where? Senses, mind, intelligence. There is lust. So if you can understand, here is the enemy, and if you try to drive out the enemy, you take precaution. What is that precaution? You engage your senses in Krishna conscious activity. The lust will have no more place to attack your senses or sit on your senses. You engage your mind in Krishna. Immediately, the lust from the mind will go away. Similarly, you apply your intelligence how to work on Krishna consciousness. These are the processes. The Krishna consciousness movement is like that. Apply your intelligence, apply your mind, apply your senses only for Krishna. And there is no one lust. You are free. There is no sitting place. Just like this glass. There is water. So how you can put in ink? Because there is no sitting place. Similarly, if you place Krishna in your mind, so lust will automatically go away. Just like if you place light in this room, the darkness automatically will go. There is no place for darkness. Krishna is light. The sun is light. As soon as there is sun rising, the whole darkness of night automatically disappears. So try to place Krishna in your mind, in your sensual activities, in your intelligence. Then there will be no more lust. It will finish. Go on.
41. Therefore, O Arjuna, death of the Bharati, in the very beginning, curb the great symbol of sin, lust, by regulating the senses and slay the destroyer of knowledge and self-realization.
Yes. Sir. Regulating, how can you regulate the senses? Not by artificial means. The yoga practice, of course, is meant for controlling the senses. But nobody can practice in this age perfectly yoga, neither one can control the senses. But this is practically. Just like our sense, tongue, we want to taste very palatable dishes. Now you supply palatable Krishna prasada, you forget going to hotel immediately. This sort of process is in Krishna consciousness. We don't simply prohibit that you don't do this, but we supply something which is engaged by the senses and the mind, the intelligence, so that you do not require to be engaged otherwise. Positive and negative. Simply negative is no good. The Krishna consciousness is positive engagement. So there is no question of negative. Negative is already there. If you are taking nice food stuff, they automatically you give up obnoxious and nonsense food stuff. But if I say, don't take this food stuff, this is not good. And if I don't supply you nice food stuff, naturally you are hungry, you will have to take whatever is there. Just like sometimes you have seen the dogs, they are eating stool, their own stool. So I was talking this, one of my students told me that in the last war in the concentrated camp, the human being, they also ate their stool out of hunger. Yes. There was no food, so they ate their own stool. So when there is no opportunity of good occupation, one must be satisfied with this nonsense occupation. So this Krishna consciousness is so nice that one who is occupied with this moment, he cannot go anymore to so-called lusty and other nonsense occupation. Go on.
22. The working senses are superior to dull matter. Mind is higher than the senses. Intelligence is still higher than the mind. And he, the soul, is even higher than the intelligence.
So we have to come to the platform of soul. Generally, we are on the dull material platform of this body. And this body means senses. And the center of all these senses is the mind. And the mind is also controlled by intelligence. And when you go above the platform of intelligence, then you come to the platform of spiritual soul or Krishna consciousness. That is your position. So one has to try to transcend all these three stages of material platform and then come to the spiritual platform.
Yes.
Thus knowing oneself to be transcendental, the material senses, mind, and intelligence, one should control the lower self by the higher self, and thus, by the spiritual strength, conquer this insatiable enemy known as love. This third chapter of the Bhagavad Gita is conclusively directed to Krishna consciousness. Through knowing oneself as the eternal servitor of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, without considering impersonal voidness as the ultimate goal, and ultimate end. In the material existence of life, one is certainly influenced by propensities of lust and desire for dominating the resources of material nature. Thus desire for overlording and sense gratification are the greatest enemies of the conditioned soul. But by the spirit,
generally, those who are under the bodily concept of life, they are struggling day and night. Why? To have overlordship of this material nature. This is material activity. And those who are on the mental platform, they are trying to philosophize, mental speculation. Those who are still intelligent, they are taking to this yoga practice by intelligently trying to controlling the senses. But as soon as you come to the spiritual platform, automatically these things are done, because all your senses, mind and intelligence are occupied by Krishna consciousness. God.
Yes, God.
One day I give up work and subscribe to you all of a sudden, but by gradually developing one's Krishna consciousness, one can be situated in a transcendental position without being influenced by the material senses and the mind, by steady intelligence directed toward one's pure identity. This is the sum total of this chapter. In the immature state of material existence, philosophical speculations and artificial attempts to control the senses by the so-called practice of yogic posture can never help a man toward a spiritual life. He must be trained in Krishna consciousness by a higher intelligence. Thus ends Bhaktivedanta Purport in the third chapter of the Srimad Bhagavad Gita in the matter of karma yoga, or the action of one to strive to in Krishna consciousness.
Okay. Any question? Yes.
In our fourth purport of the year, we're talking about putting the position of the queen, how we're putting the position into the previous gauges,
Gauge.
I'll take one of the
Yes. Did you read it? Where?
So what is your question?
People that are engaged in Bhakti action in their life, I thought that Krishna is merciful and he will provide them with the body to have as much Bhakti as they want. I can't see how a person could evolve into that body of his tree who's engaged in self and Bhakti activities and wants to be invited to.
I don't follow.
The Bhagavad Gita is stated that whatever one's consciousness is during his lifetime would be at the time of his death. And that will determine his next body.
Yes.
Now one who is very lucky, is living very luckily during his lifetime, his mind will be on his body.
Yes.
So
there are many kinds or varieties of life. Just like somebody is very lusty and he wants sex enjoyment so many times a day. So there are many animals, many birds, they are giving the opportunity like that. Just like the pigeons, the sparrows, there are many birds, the swans, the ducks. They have got every day 20 times sex intercourse. So this facility is given to them. Similarly, somebody wants to eat meat and blood. He is given the chance to become a tiger. So Krishna is giving chance everyone. And one who is very dull, cannot understand simply the sense gratification they are making, they are made the dullest possible, like trees stand up for thousands of years. So all these different varieties of life, 8,400,000, we have got different varieties. That you can calculate. There are three qualities. 3 × 3 = 9. 3 × 3 that becomes 9. And 9 × 9 becomes 81. Automatically it becomes more than 8 million. So God's kingdom, his calculation, his fine judgment is very difficult to understand, but practically we see there are so many varieties of life. Why? They have been given chance, all life. You want this sort of life? Here it is. Take it. Accept it. So they are transmigrating from one life to another, one life to another, one life to another. Out of many such millions of living entities, one who comes under Krishna consciousness by the grace of Krishna and his devotee spiritual master, his life is successful. He gets the clue to get out of this entanglement. Otherwise, he is to travel within these 8,400,000 of this is all right. So Krishna is giving chance, whatever you want. But he is talking also the ultimate goal of your life. Sarvadharmaan paritrajyamam ekam saranam. You give up this searching out of your happiness in your own way by transmigrating from one kind of life to another, one position to another. You just take shelter of me and I take charge of you. This is the whole proposition of Bhagavad Gita. This is Krishna consciousness. One has to give up searching out of happiness according to his own plan, but he has to submit himself to Krishna, who will take care and will give you all happiness that you desire. That is Krishna Bhakti. Anyone who is in the material world, he is lusty. Maybe difference of degrees, that doesn't matter. But he is lusty. Kamayasa krodhayasa rajaguna samadva. Everyone is trying to lord it over the material nature. That is lust. Now, the ant is trying to lord it over the material nature in his own way, and the big politician, he is trying to lord it over the material nature in a different way. Everyone is trying. So that lording it over the material nature is a sign of lust. So you can take it for granted that anyone who is within this material world, he has got that contamination of lust, maybe manifested in divine degree, that who has come to Krishna consciousness, he has no more lust, because he wants to satisfy Krishna. He doesn't want to satisfy his senses. That is Krishna consciousness. His aim of life is how Krishna will be pleased. That's all. And lust means how my senses will be satisfied. That is the difference. The process of satisfying is going on. In our conditioned life, we are trying to satisfy our senses. And in our Krishna consciousness life, we are satisfying to please Krishna. That is the difference. So my work is not stopped, but the goal of life is changed. That is liberation. You don't say that you kill your desire. No. You purify your desire to satisfy Krishna. That's all. Now your desire is to satisfy your senses. That's all. This has to be purified, that you shall desire, but you should desire to satisfy Krishna. Then your perfection. In one way, it is very simple and easy, because I'll know how to satisfy my senses. I'm doing it life after life. The same endeavor should be engaged for satisfying Krishna. That's all. The process has not to be learned by me. I know it. Simply account has to be changed. That's all. So Krishna consciousness is very simple and easy. Immediately you come to the spiritual platform or transcendental platform. That is explained in the Chaitanya Charitamrita. Lust and love. What is the difference between lust and love? In the material world there is no love, because everyone is directed by lust, the so-called love. A young boy is trying to love a young girl, or a young girl is trying to love a young. But the background is lust. There is no love. It is simply a show of love. Therefore, after satisfying lust, there is divorce, there is separation.
So in the material world, there is no possibility of love. It is all lust. Love is only possible when you love God. There is no lust. There is no question of sense gratification. Simply for love. Krishna is my lover, Krishna is my master, Krishna is my friend. Just like Arjuna. Arjuna is loving Krishna as friend. So he is so great lover that in the beginning he hesitated to fight, how shall I kill my kinsman? But when he understood, Krishna my friend desires, oh, never mind. So there was no lust, simply love of Krishna. So lust and love, which means the same thing is there. Simply one has to change the account. That's all. Lusty people, they are working on account of sense gratification. And lover of Krishna is working for Krishna's satisfaction. The activity may appear superficially the same. Just like these boys in Krishna consciousness, people may say, what is that doing? They are also eating, they are also cooking and offering Krishna. And they say, this Krishna consciousness, what is the difference between this food stuff and the hotel food stuff? In this way they may think, they are also typewriting, they are also using dictaphone and this tape recorder and all this material. But they do not know that everything is being used for Krishna. Therefore, there is far difference. There is no lust. So you can utilize everything if it is in Krishna consciousness, not for satisfaction of your lust. Then your life is sublime. You do not reject anything, but you accept anything. The only difference is that we do not accept anything for our sense gratification. We do not accept this tape recorder for sense gratification, singing or dancing. We accept this tape recorder to record Krishna's glory, to record Krishna's topic. So this is the difference of it. Nirbandhe Krishna Sambandhe Yukta Vairagya Muchyate. Dovetail everything in Krishna consciousness and it is perfect. And dovetail anything with your lust or sense gratification, apparently it may be very good, nice thing, but it is nonsense. It is lust. So somebody is using religion for satisfaction of his senses. Somebody is using Bhagavad Gita for satisfaction of his senses. We do not wish to discuss all this in detail. But actually, there is no training how to use things in Krishna consciousness. That is being now introduced in this moment, Krishna consciousness. How to make everything perfect, dovetail in Krishna consciousness. Any other question?
Is it also the case that there are amongst the forms many souls that are on the process of evolution and going upward?
Yes. Just like you are stepping some staircases, you go to the second floor or third floor, but somewhere you fall down again. So you have to cross again the steps. You follow? That does not mean because you crossed all the steps and went to the third floor, now you have fallen down. You have to cross again. So there is a regular evolutionary process from trees to worms, reptiles, from reptiles to birds, from birds to bees, varieties of bees, and from bees to human life. These are the stepping stone evolutionary process. But even if you are human being, if you fall down to the category of the trees, then you have to again go up step by step. You have to come to the form of the worms and reptiles and birds and bees. Therefore, we should not miss this chance. This is intelligence. If I miss this chance, then I do not know where I am falling down again. So there is no teaching, there is no knowledge in the whole world. They are driven now just like animals. This educational institution, universities, there is no department of knowledge. How the living entities are working, how they are being transformed, they are falling down, how they... No. A very risky civilization. The people thought, try to understand this Krishna consciousness philosophy very seriously, if they at all want their own good. From trees, the worms. Do you see it? From the flowers there are some butterflies. You have seen? The flowers generate some worms and they transform into butterflies. You have seen it? Then gradually they will become birds from butterflies. And from birds, different birds, then they will become beasts. Four-legged, and then the four legs turn into two hands and just like gorilla, monkey. Then you'll come to this beautiful form, and if you miss this opportunity, again you want to become butterfly. Go on, we'll check you, become butterfly. Nature will not excuse you. As soon as you want to become butterfly, yes, come on. Here it is. They do not know. They are thinking this is a flickering lad. Ah, let us enjoy. Very risky civilization. Jalajanavalakkhani sabra lakhavinsati. These are all stated in the Puranas. These books were meant for human society. They are not reading. They are reading all rascal novels and literatures and sex life, frauds and this and that. How they are wasting their time. Govindas was showing me one literature, Hawaii. Siksha, the boys and girls, they are enjoying this, what is called, this surface, spending money, you see. But there is no instruction how they are wasting their time. this human form of life simply by jumping in the water. And I think I am enjoying butterfly. They do not know the value of this life. And the system of civilization is encouraging them to do this without any good information. What kind of condemned civilization is that? Pulling by force to the darkest region of hell. They do not know. Although the hellish condition of life is in the front, there are so many varieties of life. They do not question where from these lives come. This is Krishna consciousness. To apply the whole energy towards Krishna. That's all. That energy may be utilized in different ways. Back to Krishna. This is Krishna consciousness. Chant Hare Krishna.